Hello, thank you so much for having me here. What I'm going to talk today is something is actually not usually related to my academic research, but hopefully, you know, will benefit from your comments and actually from what has been discussed before. This is mostly empirical. I'm going to talk about an investigation of risk factors in high frequency currency markets. So it is, to some extent, it's subject to all the criticisms, if you want, of what Cesare has been discussing before in his presentation. Let me immediately tell you what is the scope of the talk. Is to study observable risk factors that can drive FX prices at high frequency. Few questions within this framework. The first one is if it's possible to identify risk factors for foreign exchange at high frequency the same way you would do, you know, like usual, you know, like daily or monthly frequencies, or even yearly frequencies, as some people do. And if that is possible, are factors usually considered by market makers for hedging their risk priced into FX pairs? And then also another important question is, do these factors have any economic value, in the sense that can you use these things actually out of sample and perhaps make some money? Let's put it, you know, in a very simple way. Why this is of interest, I have a very special example for this, because this partially is also driven by interest in the industry. So you think you are a market maker, you hold US funds, I mean US dollars, and you want essentially, you know, to have a zero net exposure. So, you know, like you want to invest some money, you know, in New Zealand dollars, and what you invested, the dollar amount you invest in New Zealand dollar, you want to go short instead, maybe the same in Swiss franc, and so on. So that's what I mean. Zero net open position. So as I said, of course, you are holding foreign currency during the day. And the way you skew then your prices will determine, so even though you are passively, you know, providing prices and getting executed, but the way you skew your prices will actually determine how much you will hold of each currency. The reason why I'm giving this specific example is, in these cases, execution is passive, is not aggressive, as usually it is. So transaction costs are different. It's a completely different game. So this will be important when I present the economic value of this this study, and you'll see why. But anyway, you are then the market maker, you skew your prices, but the way you want to skew your prices, so the sort of inventory you want to hold, can depend on, you know, like risk factors you want to be exposed to. All these risk factors I will consider are based to some extent to what people will use in the industry at a high frequency, and that's why they actually will be observable. Though I will relate to existing studies also in the FX literature at lower frequencies. There are some challenges, for example, when you start talking about high frequencies, what is the right frequency to use, an estimation of anything that has to do with the high frequency data is more difficult, usually because there is more, you know, there is lots of noise, so the signal to noise ratio is very, very low. And on top of that, there is, you know, like what's this huge area studied in the literature, that is market microstructure. So there are complications. So here I'm going to advertise a little bit what I do, to sell it to you perhaps. So what the paper that did present, what I'll try to do with the presentation is to propose a methodology that uses multiple time horizons, so you don't fix yourself necessarily to one frequency. This is not exactly correct, you will see why, but the motivation at least was this. Then I'm interested in deriving factor loading restrictions because I'm using multiple frequencies and to make, you know, estimation robust. And I'm trying to do it, you know, using primitive conditions. It's not particularly difficult at all. It actually, when you will see it, will be quite obvious, but it's very important in a sense. It will make things easy. And then from these derive some inferential procedures when you use when you do estimation using stochastic discount factors and multiple horizons. So this has been already discussed partly, you know, like to some extent in the previous presentation of Cesare, and lots of these things I do actually are subject to those to the criticisms he raised. Then I also suggest and study some observable pricing factors during liquid US hours. I will derive some empirical results that hopefully will contribute to understanding of and the role of these factors. And then, as usually many of these empirical papers do, I will try to to evaluate both the methodology that I use as well as the sort of models, or if you want, you know, like the factors through a sort of out-of-sample exercise, which usually people refer to as the economic value. You construct some portfolios, you know, based on your methodology, and you see if there is some value there, if there is some positive returns. And I will show that for the sample I use, there is some positive returns. The way the whole thing is constructed implies that then there is some persistency in these risk premia associated to the factors at high frequencies. I'll give you the details, what I mean by high frequency, what I mean, you know, persistency and so on. But let's do it as I get there, given the time is short. And so, but in a way, then this also will contribute partially, at least, to the literature on forecasting imposing some economic restrictions, if you want, or asset pricing restrictions. As I said, I'll be specific as we get there. So the methodology is to use data at all frequencies, and I will use what's called functional data, and what I call here functional data returns. Again, you will see what it is. In a moment, I'll set up some model as a building block, which is just a standard semi-martingale, and then I derive some restrictions on the factor loadings so that they don't depend on time, and I can do things at multiple frequencies, estimating one single parameter. Parameter matrix, invariant of time horizon. And essentially, I mean, I think the main point is really to keep it simple, to aid interpretability and make it hopefully, you know, like simple to understand. And of course, because of that, subject, however, to criticism. There is so much, there are so many references in effects factor pricing. So, but a few recent, these ones, and actually Lucio Sarno at Cass Business School has loads of paper on effects. So anything he has written a lot is related to factors for effects. And then there is an unrelated literature, which however will be partially, you know, like, a tool that I use for doing things on multiple horizons is the literature on functional data. So I will define what this functional data is for those of you who don't know, because they're not too common in econometrics. So let me start, you know, just introducing a very simple model, just to set up ideas and also to derive simple results in a way, but at least hopefully simple but useful results. So, you know, I have a log price for the kth asset. It's just essentially, you know, an ETHOS process. These terms here, these factors, are independent Brownian motions, and the drift and volatilities are independent of the Brownian motions. Again, you know, like a simplification, you know, like I'm disregarding any leverage effects or whatever, even though, you know, in FX, it becomes a bit different than how you would interpret these things in for stocks. And the drift and the volatility satisfy some, you know, usual assumptions and moments and so on, integrability over some contact interval. But what I assume is that these volatility processes are stationary, so that, you know, I can compute correlations, right? Things, you could, of course, replace these and say things are not stationary, they are ergodic. I have a very large sample, I do averages, at the end, you know, more or less, I get the same stuff. I actually don't have a very long sample. So, you know, like, it makes more sense to have assumptions that is suitable for what I'm doing. What is missing here, which immediately someone who deals with the high frequency will tell you, is market microstructures. Actually, I will show you that they're not so important in this case, even though usually, of course, they're incredibly important for high frequency. But, you know, like as a benchmark model to check whether things will be subject really to market microstructure or not, I also introduce a simple model, and then I will correct for any bias that comes from this simple model. And it just ends up for the sample again, you know, like it didn't really matter. So, but that at least was to some extent reassuring. So there is just a standard, in a sense, you know, like market microstructure model where the noise only appears when there is at the sampling periods. So the prices are not sampled continuously, are only sampled at fixed intervals. Every time you sample the prices at some fixed interval, there will be some noise that is added with some non-zero standard deviation or variance. And again, you know, like the market microstructure as a simplifying assumption is uncorrelated with the price. We know that actually for stocks, for example, this doesn't seem to be the case at all. However, just to justify the fact that all I'm going to show you will be without market microstructures, it's also true that I'm going to sample mid prices, and when you sample mid price quotes, usually the impact of market microstructure is quite reduced. So, but the reason why I introduced this model here is because, as I said, in the paper, at least I also test and carry out the estimations also under the assumption that there is, you know, market microstructure of this kind, of this type, of course, you know, like, and I get very similar results. If other models where maybe, you know, prices are correlated with a market microstructure may give substantially different results. So it's important, you know, to know what is, you know, what I checked as a robustness, right? I only check for this sort of alternative model, if you want. So as I said, the results are derived without market microstructures. When I correct, they weren't particularly different. The results were qualitatively the same, which I think is important. So let me try to define what I call functional returns. So imagine just some five minute equally spaced times. Yeah, so each of these is 5 minutes apart. And I have the log price for the kth currency. What I mean is the log price in the kth currency of 1 unit of USD. So that, you know, always my base currency is USD. You know, let's say USD investor. Everything needs to be in terms of units of the same currency to make sense. And I define, this is actually my terminology, if you want, a functional return as the following difference. Don't look at this for the moment, it confuses you. But it's just the log difference, right? So the log return. But if you can see, it's the log return for a horizon of t, a t log return, right? And the interval is standardized, a 5 minute interval is standardized to be in 0, 1. So, you know, a t equal to to 1 will bring me from ti to ti plus 1, you know, which is a 5 minutes. So I'm going to consider basically returns over different horizons every 5 minutes. So non-overlapping intervals. I have non-overlapping intervals, and I look, you know, at the evolution, the trajectory, if you want, of the price, the log trajectory of the price within 5 minutes intervals. By the way, I mean, please do interrupt me anytime if you have any questions. At the end, usually people don't ask questions, so it's better, you know, you ask me now, and I will target at least to finish exactly on time with no questions. So if you want, you stop me while I talk. This extra term is just the correction for the forward premium. So I is the interest rate in USD in the US, and IF is the interest rate in the foreign country. And this tau is basically the fraction of time in a year. So don't worry. But anyway, I'm deriving essentially what you know in for example, if you consider stocks, excess returns. But for currencies, excess returns, if you want, are defined in terms of, you know, the forward premium. So that's how you get them. All that means is, however, that under risk neutrality, as for stocks, you know, like the expectations of this thing is always zero. So I will also, you know, introduce, because I'm talking about factors, what I call, you know, factors trajectories. I use a superscript just to identify, you know, the health factor. So, you know, this F is a vector, as it will be for this. When you see an R without a subscript, it will be a vector. And again, you know, notation, the covariance between the returns and the factors is a matrix. It's the covariance, you know, at these two different times, because every time, right, within each segment, I can have covariances at different times. And they are defined in this way. So S identifies the time, and everything is stationary, yeah? And T again is another time. And I will add a subscript N for the empirical estimator. So just to maybe add a little bit of intuition, this thing is a sample mean at time S, but these ones, actually, even under, you know, under the assumptions that they are ETHOS processes, they can be estimated at any S consistently, even though I have 1 million points. So I do it every, you know, like, I don't know, nanoseconds. Well, obviously, you don't sample at that frequency, right? But the thing is, these quantities essentially represent random variables in a Banach space. And so you are guaranteed, you know, consistency for all of these estimators, especially, you know, under the assumptions of the basic model, let's call it basic model, the ETHOS process, for any S. So even though you get a vector, a big vector, right, because depend, no matter how often I sample, still get consistency. It's completely different, you know, than just getting consistency for a vector, right? It's a different animal, anyway. So this equation, actually, you have seen it already today. It's written slightly different because what I'm going to use, partially inappropriately, is log returns rather than arithmetic returns. So in the case of log returns, this equation will only hold under, you know, log normality of prices. However, you don't really worry about that at such high frequencies. Log returns, arithmetic returns are so close to each other, given, you know, like the small volatility, you know, like relative to the return, sorry, to the price. So at the end, you say that the return are priced correctly by a discount factor. So I'm assuming, you know, since you have seen it already, I'm going a little bit quick on here. But, you know, there is a stochastic discount factor that will price the assets, the currencies, if this equation holds. Basically, you know, the, if you want, the covariance between the discount factor and the returns is zero. Not exactly covariance, sorry. Yeah, because there is a one here. So These F, as I said, they will be the factors. I will tell you exactly what these factors are. So, but this restriction then can be used to estimate things, as you will see. And the above implies the usual linear pricing restriction, where these B are the factor loadings, and the lambda are the market price of risk or risk premium for the factors, depending, you know, how what language you prefer. These are just equations that say exactly what they are. But what is interesting is this framework will tell you that B will depend on T. It's obviously, you know, it's unpleasant in that case, if that were the case. But now suppose, you know, that also the factors follow this sort of basic model, you know, like this Itô's process, everything like what I discussed before for the returns. The only thing is I'm also assuming that the expectation of the cross of these volatilities between the factors and the returns are also stationary. I need some form of stationarity. I want essentially to get rid of the dependence on T, so that then I will be able to estimate things at multiple frequencies and disregard the time dependence.
Well, that you're saying the covariance.
So I'm assuming that the covariance, so as the simplest thing, I think let's talk about cap M, even though it doesn't apply here, right? But I'm assuming that the volatility of the market and the volatility of, well, the correlation between the market and the returns are time invariant. Obviously, in practice, they are not. There will be heterogeneity, but you know there is usually at least some sort of ergodicity. That's why, you know, at least people can justify doing these long-term estimations. Here is a bit different. I actually do, you know, estimation at very short windows, and so you can think about there is some sort of local stationarity, if you want. But, you know, under these conditions, it turns out that it's very basic, this, but still it's quite useful, that the factor loadings will be time invariant. They won't depend on time. And I will be able then to use this in a moment. Also, you know, like, obviously, the usual pricing relationship, this one that I discussed before, just implies the usual factor model with no other additional assumptions. And so, you know, like I can estimate, if you want a factor model at different horizons with a fixed B. So the B won't depend on time according to this result. So it will be useful. I can use, you know, data at multiple frequencies always to estimate the same B, the same factor loading. Is that sort of clear? Please do ask questions. So let me say then what is that I'm going to estimate. I mean, from what you said before, and the previous also presentation, I'm going to estimate, you know, the discount factor parameters, a factor model, and I will try to say something about the risk premia that are loaded by the currencies, and eventually do something with this, make some predictions perhaps. So what, however, usually people do is they don't try to price all the assets possible. Often it makes sense to price either linear combinations of the assets that make sense, because you are more interested perhaps in some portfolios than others, or, you know, like it's also very common to price some portfolios that are orthogonal to each other. That's what I'm going to do. But obviously, what orthogonality means at different frequencies needs just to be defined. When you see it, it's very intuitively, but still you need to, you know, to define that. So you can think about, you can introduce a stochastic processes, so k-dimensional stochastic processes that are uncorrelated with each other. And then you can say that under the whole setup, so the basic setup, you know, this basic model with these uncorrelated Brownian motions, you can define the correlation between the returns at all the frequencies as the usual, the standard, you know, like, decompositions of a matrix that is diagonal with eigenvectors on the side. However, this matrix now is a matrix function. So it's a function, it's a covariance matrix function. It's not just a simple matrix. So by using this simple tool, and there are some extra details and information you can extract from it, one can define these orthogonal portfolios. So in this case, you know, these returns will be orthogonal to each other. And what I'm going to use, as it was discussed before, you can use, for example, GMM. You can use, you know, these Hansen-Jagannathan distance. However, since I'm interested in multiple horizons, what I'm going to use is the same version, in a way, of the Hansen-Jagannathan distance, but averaging across frequencies. So averaging across different horizons. So everything depends on T, I remind you, is the frequency on the... Oh, really? Okay, so anyway, from this framework and this all, you can do what has been discussed in the previous presentation. You can derive parameters that will be, you know, normally distributed. The form is slightly different. You can also derive, using some simulation methods or the bootstrap, the distribution of this quantity that needs to be simulated. So you can actually check whether factors are priced or not. So let me get directly into the data and describe briefly the results. So the data are just returns over essentially the CME main trading session. The factors, usually in the studies, two factors are enough to explain 90% of the portfolios at frequencies such as a month. Here, you know, to explain 90%, you need seven factors, unobservable factors. Of course, I won't have something so parametrized. So as you can, this just plots the data at 5 minutes, sampling. Okay, there is a lot actually to say about this, but I will have to skip that. Let me just say what the observable factors are: the E-mini, S&P futures, the dollar index, and then two factors that are the carry factor, which is basically going long for currencies with the lowest forward premium and short for currencies with the highest forward premium. This has been considered in the literature at lower horizons, while this other factor that I call safe haven is just going long on Swiss and yen, and they will represent an outflow towards safer currencies during extreme market turmoil. I will just comment briefly on what these factors means. I'll give you returns and I will conclude, even though most of the paper is there still. So the E-mini futures, usually when there is lots of increase in risk aversion, what market maker observe is an increase in the S&P futures. That's why it's used to capture an increase in risk aversion, contrary to what instead the dollar index does. The dollar index increases when there is an increase in risk aversion. So it's very similar to some extent to this other factor, even though it is negatively correlated to it. So I just want to show you one picture. I summarize some results and that's it. So this shows a picture of the factors. This is the S&P divided by 5 to make sure, you know, like you get the same scale. So the carry trade follows more or less the same behavior as the S&P 500, while this dollar index and the Swiss franc and yen together, they are negatively correlated because actually they have opposite signs. But as you can see, they are downward sloping. So there is a sort of also integrating relationship. There is lots of information that can be extracted from this. So I can't comment on any of these things. So let me just say one thing. From all these, you can estimate the models as they are, and at the end, estimate the risk premia using the approach in the model, mixing different frequencies. And what happens is you get very different, so a lot. Let me just summarize this. Let me just say what this table is and I conclude. So this table, what it does, it provides basically the returns on an auto-sample exercise where you do some invariance optimization but with some constraints on the portfolio. And you have four different approaches. Simple is just use the usual factor model. GMM is where you estimate your risk premia using a GMM. And these two other columns also use the previous methods, but also averaging across frequencies. As you can see from the returns, you can extract lots of information by averaging across frequencies. These numbers here, not the one in parentheses, are the annualized returns on the portfolios in basis points. So 747 is 7%. And the numbers in parentheses are the standard errors. So you can see that going, you know, using all the frequencies actually improves a lot the returns. Of course, this is subject to the sample and being used. So anyway, the paper contains also interesting information about the loadings. So that I guess I have zero time. So if you're interested, you can look there and you can understand the role of these factors, especially dollar index and this factor I call safe haven. So thank you.
Thanks.